हेलो गाइस, आई होप यू ऑल आर डूइंग गुड। आई एम विशाली कीकान एंड वी आर डिस्कसिंग द VLSI टेक्नोलॉजी। इन दैट वी आर डिस्कसिंग द केमिकल वेपर डेपोजिशन एंड द डाइलेक्ट्रिक थिन फिल्म्स। एंड टुडे दिस इज द लास्ट वीडियो ऑफ दिस टॉपिक एंड आई होप यू ऑल हैव वॉच्ड ऑल ऑफ द प्रीवियस वीडियोज, बिकॉज नाउ टुडे इन दिस वीडियो वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट द प्रोसेस ट्रेंड्स एंड द ट्रबल शूटिंग। सो टू अंडरस्टैंड दीज टू टॉपिक्स आर रिलेटेड टू ऑल ऑफ द प्रीवियस टॉपिक्स। सो यू मस्ट वॉच ऑल ऑफ द प्रीवियस वीडियोज। इफ यू हैव still not watch them, please watch all of the videos on this topic and then come to this video. So we are starting with the process trends and the troubleshooting. These are two topics which are interrelated to each other, and this is why we are talking about both of them in the same video. So what is process trend and what is troubleshooting? So if I have a particular input, if I have the input parameters, for the input parameters I am going to get a particular process response. If I change the input parameters, I am going to get a changed process response. So if even if I am changing the input parameters, I am not getting the changed process response, there is some problem with this input or there is some problem with the process as well. Now, if we find out there is some problem with the process, we need to troubleshoot. We need to get to know what was the root cause of this problem. This is called troubleshooting. If I get to know what is the root cause, I can change the root cause of the problem. I can eliminate it, and this is how I can get the best outcome for the particular input parameter. This is called troubleshooting, and the process trend means for a particular input, I am getting a particular process response. I hope you understood now very well about these two topics. If you have any doubt, you can put the doubt in the comment, because this is the starting. If you don't know the starting, then it would be difficult for you to catch up with me. Okay, so now coming to the Silane PECVD process trend. We have already talked about the Silane PECVD process. So what are the process trends? If I am going to increase the temperature, at the increased temperature, I am going to get a higher deposition rate. This is the first process trend. Second process trend is that if I am going to increase the temperature, it is going to give me better step coverage. It is going to give me better film quality. So these three process trends are associated with the higher temperature in the Silane PECVD process. If I am going to give higher temperature, first I am going to give the better deposition rate. Second, I am going to get the better step coverage. And third, I am going to get a better film quality. So I hope you understood what is process trend for Silane PECVD. At higher diffusion rate, I will be getting higher number of molecules of the precursors inside the boundary layer. So inside the boundary layer, if I have higher molecules, so which means I will be getting the bigger width of the deposition layer, which means the deposition rate would be higher, right? So if I am getting the PMD, it is using a higher temperature. For IMD and PD, we are not getting, we are not using a very high temperature. We are using the temperature around 400 degrees Celsius. So you can see the trend of deposition rate with the temperature. If I am increasing the temperature, the deposition rate is increasing. So you can see the process window. Inside the process window, you can see on increasing the temperature, the deposition is linearly increasing, right? So this is the trend or the process trend associated with the temperature increase. Coming to the RF power. So now coming to the stress and the RF power. So this is a process trend associated with the RF power. If I'm increasing the RF power, the stress is going to increase inside the process window linearly. You can see the graph of the stress versus the RF power inside the process window. Right, you can see the Silane PECVD process trend depending upon the Silane flow. If I am going to increase the Silane flow, the deposition is going to increase. If I am getting more number of Silanes in the boundary layer, obviously the deposition rate is going to increase. So in the process window, you can see the deposition is increasing linearly with the increase in the Silane flow. Also, the refract is increasing linearly if I am increasing the Silane flow. So you can see the process trends like stress and WERR associated with the Silane flow. So if I am going to increase the Silane flow, stress is going to decrease, whereas WERR is going to increase. So now coming to the relationship of deposition rate and the RF power. So you can see on the X axis we have RF power. On the Y axis we have the deposition. So here if I am increasing the RF power, the free radicals are increasing. If I increase the RF power, it is going to generate the more free radicals. If I have more free radicals, which means the reaction would be enhanced. The reaction rate is higher, which means the deposition rate would be higher. So here you can see the deposition is increasing if I am increasing the RF power. Whereas if I have increased the RF power way too much, then the adsorption will be reduced, right? So if the RF power is way too much, which means the ion bombardment would be high, which means etching would be done simultaneously, which means deposition is not that much high, which means deposition rate is reduced and the adsorption rate is reduced, ion bombardment or etching is increased. Okay, so which means deposition here is reducing. Okay, so RF power process trend with the deposition, now you understand with the help of this graph, right? So now coming to the relationship of deposition rate and the temperature. So now if I am increasing the temperature, the deposition rate is going to increase. Why? The chemical reaction is going to become faster if I am getting at higher temperature. So after a particular temperature, we are not getting the increased reaction rate or the increased deposition rate at a higher temperature. So you can see in this process window, here in this process window, the reaction rate is increasing, which means the deposition rate is exponentially increasing. But here in this process window, the deposition rate is constant with respect to temperature. So here I cannot generalize it. I cannot say the deposition rate is only increasing. The deposition rate is increasing as well as it is constant, or it might be decreasing as well, right, at increasing temperature. So now coming to the PETEOS process trend. So if I am increasing the RF power, the deposition rate might be increased or it may be decreased. So it depends upon the particular RF power that I am giving. Compressive stress is going to increase. In the process window, deposition rate will be going down, right? So at the higher temperature, deposition rate might be increasing or it will be decreasing. In the process window, deposition rate will be decreasing. So if I am increasing the TEOS flow, deposition rate is increasing, compressive stress is decreasing. So you can see the PE process trends with the TEOS flow rate. If I am increasing the TEOS flow, deposition is going to increase and the refraction is going to be constant. So refract is constant and the deposition is increasing. So you can see stress and the WERR ratio also with the TEOS flow. Stress is decreasing, WERR is increasing with the increase in the TEOS flow. So you can see this is amazing trend based upon the temperature. Initially at the lower temperature, the deposition is increasing exponentially. So here it is done due to the increase in the chemical reaction rate. If the chemical reaction rate of the TEOS is increasing, which means the deposition would be faster. So deposition rate would be higher if I am increasing the temperature, but above the 400 degrees Celsius, so the deposition rate is going to reduce because here the adsorption rate is reduced at the higher temperature or at 400 degrees Celsius. So in the window of 400 to 550 degrees Celsius, you can see in this process window, the deposition rate is negative, which means we are getting more etching than the deposition. So you can see the process trends for the ozone TEOS process. Temperature increase, which means deposition might go up or down. In the process window, deposition rate is going down. So TEOS flow increase, which means deposition rate is increasing. So there is a question, for both PE and ozone TEOS process, we have seen that the maximum deposition rate can be achieved at about 250 degrees Celsius, right? So at the 250 degrees Celsius, the deposition rate was maximum. But we are using IMD TEOS process is using normally 400 degrees Celsius temperature, and the PMD and the STI process is using even higher temperature, like the 550 degrees Celsius. Why? So at the higher temperature, I will be getting the better step coverage and the better film quality, and this is the need for the STI layer, for the PMD layer, and for the IMD layer as well. And this is the reason we are generating all of them at a higher temperature to get the better step coverage and the better film quality. Now coming to the troubleshooting. What is troubleshooting? Troubleshooting is getting to know from where I'm getting the different process response, even if I'm not changing the input parameter, or if I'm changing the input parameter, I'm not getting the desirable or the desired process response. Right? So this is called troubleshooting. To get to know where is the problem, to resolve that problem, this is troubleshooting. So it can be learned from the hand of experience. If I have the bigger and bigger hand-on experience on a particular chip or the particular process, I would be getting to know where exactly the problem is arising from, right? So sudden process change is either going to get me suddenly changed response, or it will be giving me the change response in a long term. So it can give me gradual responses, gradual wrongs, or sudden wrongs. If I'm getting the sudden wrong, I will be suddenly getting to know, yes, there is some problem in this process. But if there is a gradual process change or the gradual response change, then I need an expert who will be catching that there is a problem in the process, and it is going to give me gradual response in a long-term manner. It is going to give me a big error. So for that, I need a person with great hand-on experience on a particular chip. Sudden process change either suddenly goes wrong or gradually goes wrong and suddenly comes back. Someone should check what has changed between the good process and the bad process and vice versa. And for that, I need an experienced person. If there is a good process, there are some inputs and the various process trends. And if I have a bad process, there is some input and the various process trend. If in the bad process, in the good process, there are some changes, if these two changes must be cached and must be resolved, right? So we need to check the metrology tools first. How do we measure something? So if I am measuring the deposition rate, I need to measure the thickness of the deposited layer very accurately. If my tool is not going to give me accurate results, then I might be saying that I am getting some error, even if the error was not there. So I need to check the metrology tools first and make sure that the recipe used is right. If one measured the POTOS film with the nitride recipe, so the measured thickness would be significantly thinner. So these are all of the things that need to be taken care of. If nothing is wrong with the metrology tools, then we have to check whether the process recipe has changed or not. So first of all, we have to check the metrology tools. Second, we have to check the recipe. Okay, so process always has problem at the end of the shift. Someone should work cross shift to find out what has been changed during the shift change. At the end, at the extremes, we are getting the problem. So one has to check from end to end that where is the problem. Something must be changed that put the process back to the normal at the beginning of the next shift. And so that the problem is not going on to whole of the processes, we need to check one process and then change the parameters in the upcoming process so that I will be getting good responses in the next shift. It is most likely the source of the problem as the process gradually goes wrong at the end of the shift. So most dielectric CVD processes operate in the mass transport limited regime. I have already told you we are working in the mass transport limited regime mostly. Deposition rate is mainly determined by the gas flow rate, usually C lane, and the TEOS flow rate over there. So now we have to measure these with a very accurate measurement tool. So very likely that the deposition rate problem are related with the C lane or the TEOS flow rate as well. So we can change these flow rate and we can remove the deposition rate problems. Mass flow controller and liquid flow controller should be very accurate, right? So uniformity is determined by the flow pattern. If I have the different points, I will be checking the uniformity at different points of the wafer. And if I change the flow pattern, the uniformity will be changed. So if non-uniformity pattern is center symmetric, then I can adjust the spacing of the wafer and the shower head. I'm going to show you these things with the help of pictures. Or changing the carrier gas flow rate. If I'm changing helium flow for the TEOS process, then the uniformity will be changed. Nitrogen flow is changed for the nitride process. So you can see spacing and the film profile. How if I'm changing the shower head and the distance between the shower head and the wafer, then how I am going to get the different outputs. So you can see this is my shower head, this is my wafer. If my wafer is placed very near to the shower head, I am getting very small spacing, which means I have higher deposition rate and I am getting a center thin profile. Okay, at the center I am getting a thin profile and at the edges I am getting a higher deposition rate. So you can see my wafer is placed here at some significant distance from the shower head, but it is not very far from the shower head, so I am getting the normal spacing, normal deposition rate, normal profile. So if the wafer is very far away from the shower head, you can see we are having the larger spacing at the center, lower deposition rate, which means the center thick profile we are getting. So now coming to the troubleshooting of the non-uniformity. If non-uniformity is side to side, we have to check the wafer labeling and the centering also. So after that, we can do the leak check of the slip valve of the chamber. So you can see this is the labeling and side to side profile. Okay, so this is how you can label the wafer and you can get the better uniformity. Okay, so if wafer is tilted, the thickness profile will be tilted. Okay, so you can see it. So now coming to the future trends. In the future, we are moving towards the high density plasma chemical vapor deposition of undoped silicate glass for the shallow trench isolation. For nitride or O3 TEOS, ozone TEOS oxide for sidewall spacer, PECVD or RPCVD for PMD barrier nitride, high density plasma CVD PSG for PMD, CMP for planarization, we are going to talk about CMP in the upcoming videos, low dielectric constant material for IMD, silicon oxide or nitride as the passivation dielectric. High dielectric gate dielectric. Okay, so after that, possible candidates would be TiO2, Ta2O5 and HFO2. And after that, we are going to do the RTA, rapid thermal annealing, after the CVD as well. So coming to the low dielectric constant, why do we require low dielectric constant material? So as to reduce the time delay, need to reduce the RC time delay. For that, I require low dielectric constant material. If I have the low dielectric constant material, so it is going to reduce the resistance and which in and will be reducing the RC time delay. So requires high thermal stability and high thermal conductivity and the process integration capability. So for the CVD, we are using the CSG. Okay, so CXSiYNO, which is having the dielectric constant nearly from 2.5 to 3, and alpha CF, which is CXFY, which is having the dielectric constant from 2.5 to 2.7. We can use the spin-on dielectrics SOD like hydrogen, silsiquizane, HSQ, which is having the dielectric constant nearly equal to 3, porous SOD such as Zerogels, which is having dielectric constant 2.0 to 2.5. So we can use the Damascene's process, copper metallization. So I won't be having the gap fill and the planarization problem. The main challenge would be integrating of the low dielectric with the copper metallization. So now coming to the interconnection process. So you can see we have the various structures over here. First of all, we are going to do the dielectric deposition or the planarization. Again, we are going to give the dielectric deposition or the planarization. After that, we are having the via etch, right? After that, we are having the dielectric deposition. Okay, so we are getting some step, same step coverage, and here we will be having this structure. ओके आफ्टर दैट दिस इज द इंटर कनेक्शन प्रोसेस, दिस इज माय बाया फिल एंड द पॉलिश प्रोसेस एंड देन वी आर हैविंग द ट्रेंच एच, वी आर एचिंग अप टू द ट्रेंच एंड आफ्टर दैट वी हैव द मेटल डेपोजिशन, वी कैन यूज द कॉपर एज वेल. सो यू कैन सी दिस इज हाउ आई विल बी गेटिंग अ पर्टिकुलर मेटल डेपोजिशन and after that we are having the metal etch and the metal polish process. So this is all about the interconnection process. So now in the summary, we know the applications of the dielectric thin film are STI, sidewall spacer, PMD, IMD and the PD, in which IMD application is the dominant one. Okay, so silicon oxide and the silicon nitride are the two most commonly used dielectric materials that we know. Basic CVD process sequence is the introduction of the precursor, then the precursor diffusion, adsorption, chemical reaction, gaseous byproduct desorption and diffusion. So we are talking about the surface reaction limited regime. We have talked about the mass transport limited regime as well, and the most commonly used was mass transport limited regime. So most dielectric CVD reactors operate in MTL regime only. We talked about it in detail. So PMD uses PSG or the borophosphosilicate glass. Temperature are limited by thermal budget. We have seen the process trends as well. IMD mainly uses USG or FSG. Temperature is limited by aluminium melting point. PD usually use both oxide as well as nitride. So silane and the TEOS are the two silicon sources for dielectric CVD deposition. Okay, we have talked about the process trends. If I'm using silane, if I'm using TEOS, the advantages and the disadvantages as well. Oxygen, nitrous oxide or the laughing gas and ozone are the main oxygen precursors. We have ammonia and the nitrogen as the main nitrogen gases. Fluorine chemistry is used for the dielectric CVD chamber cleaning. So we had UCF4, C2F6, C3F8 and then F3, which were mostly used as the fluorine source gases. Argon sputtering is used for the deposition ash deposition gas fill applications. CF4 and O2 HBAC is used for the planarization. Compressive stress is favored for the dielectric thin film. So compressive stress is nearly 100 MPa. So high density CVD we have discussed in detail, in which I told you SiH4 and O2 to deposit oxide. Argon for sputtering was used. High aspect ratio gap fill was used because we cannot reduce the height. Here we were using the ICP and the ECR chamber, and they are most commonly used HTP sources. So after that we were using the low dielectric constant and the copper for the future interconnection, high dielectric constant for gate and the DRAM capacitor. So these are the references. You can further read about this topic from these books, or you can suggest me any topic if I miss this anything about this topic. So I hope you like this video. If you have any further doubt, you can put the doubt in the comment and give me feedback as well, that is required. Plus if you like it, please push the like button, subscribe to the channel, and also do share it with your friends. Thank you so much.